And welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera. I'm the RPG chick.
It's a plan.
And it's a plan. Still recovering my voice. Getting some of the original tone back. I have some hot cocoa here that
Let's
should help.
Do it.
We're gonna go to outside. To the Reef of Fallen Worlds. And I have no idea what to expect. There's so many odd things in this game.
Yes, now.
Now, we're not gonna know from 1 minute to the next what the hell's gonna go on.
I need to talk to you.
He needs to talk to us.
This is the Reef of Fallen Worlds, kid.
Okay.
It's a dangerous place at the best of times. And with you lighting up the sky as you fell, well, we should get out of here as soon as possible.
Hmm. Calistage says, why were you looking at me when you said that? I wasn't, he growls. Don't be so paranoid. But when she isn't looking, he raises his eyebrows at you knowingly. Huh. What makes the Reef so dangerous? The Numenera of the past are always dangerous, but there are other dangers too, some closer than others. And he thinks, I hate to think what Calistage might do to her if I weren't here. I don't trust either of these people right now. What are the Numenera? You want me to tell you? He laughs without mirth. The Numenera are all around you, everything left over from the prior worlds. Sagus Cliffs thrives by trading artifacts from ancient civilizations. Hells, you can't scoop a handful of earth without finding drit from prior worlds mixed with it. I'm gonna guess that's one of the unique words of this setting and not a typo, which is supposed to be dirt. Something's freaking out there. That's a reflection of something freaking out over there. And I hear this crazy bird. Numenera is anything from the prior worlds, but mostly we mean the stuff of value to us. A lot of the Numenera are just oddities, fancy trinkets with little real use, but sometimes you'll get a cipher that lets you do something incredible. Artifacts are worth even more. A cipher will only do something once, but artifacts last a lot longer, though they can burn out at the most inconvenient times, he frowns. Not that it's ever happened to me. Of course, we've got no idea what most of this junk was originally intended for. In most cases, it doesn't really matter. Like, you might find what used to be a propulsion unit for a star chariot. But who the hell knows enough to build you the rest of it? Better to use it as a weapon or power source. He scowls, frustrated about something. I bet we could remake the world if we knew a tenth of the secrets of the ancients, but most days it's a challenge just to survive. So what's your story? Ask me again when we get out of here. I don't trust this damned Reef any more than the company we keep. What do you think of Calistage, as she's standing right there? A parasite disguised as a Skolark. Skolark? Don't be surprised if she betrays you before the day is done. Actually, that would be slow for her. She can't hear you say all this. Can you tell me about your tattoos? They look almost alive. These, they're nothing. Call them a consolation, if you must. He smiles grimly. Some call them by worse names, but that's because they've had occasion to run afoul of these little snakes. He looks away. This line of questioning is clearly at an end. And he thinks, my gift and curse, they remind me of it every day. What do you think we should do next? You want to fix that crystal chamber back there, yeah? First step is getting out of this Reef. Now, what if I asked him about the tattoos again? Because he said the line of a conversation was, like, completely over. He looks at the tattoo on your head, and he says, I was born with them, just like you. In a cast-off, though. Let's keep going, alright? About time, he says. Can we talk to Callister?
Watch your steps, child. This is not a place to walk lightly. There are dangers in the reef, both old and new.
What kind of dangers are there in the reef? Myriad. We walk among the Numenera, detritus of fallen worlds and antediluvian wars. Not everything in the reef knows that its wars ended long ago. Yet the true dangers are contemporary. The reef holds the promise. I'm listening to the music. This theme actually reminds me a lot of the main theme of Planescape Torment. Just like a little more mellow version of it. The reef holds the promise of treasure for the determined, but not always for the scrupulous. What's your story? She laughs. Now is not the time, dear, nor is the reef a safe place for lengthy disquisition. Disquisition? That's a different word. Rest assured, when we reach the cliffs, there will be plenty of time to swap tales. You know, I know the word inquisition, obviously, but disquisition. Interesting. Why is the resonance chamber here in the reef? That's a good question. An astute question, my dear. Yes, that's what I thought. The most likely answer is your sire discovered something he could repurpose for his own designs. If you can seal a dome as well as he did, the reef is as good as any. As good a place as any for experimentation. So we had to leave this place to ask all the questions I really wanted to. Like the echoes. What do you think of Allegern? Her lips pucker, like she's tasting something foul. He's useful, she finally says. At least he was, once. If that pompous lack-nibber, forgive my knowledge, language dear, finds one more fault with me, I expect my sisters will murder him in several realities. Lack-nibber, the mouth on her. She cocks her head to one side. There goes one now. Though somehow they can't hear each other talk about each other. I don't know. Why were you traveling with him in the first place? She sighs, the sound echoing like the hissing of a balloon. She sighs and it sounds like a balloon hissing. He was not always so sour. He was a man of science, an Aeon priest, who reveled in knowledge. But his pain has infected him, and he sees the world through that cast. It would be tragic, but... Her echoes all seem as exasperated as she, and she continues, but he is the same in every existence in which I know him. It has become incredibly tiresome. She thinks, he also said he could help me with my problem. He is a poor liar, and I a fool. Who are all these echoes of you? They are me. We are a part of each other, sisters across infinite realities. We share our experiences and power. What's that old saying? That experience brings wisdom? I must be the wisest person in Sega's cliffs. The wisest across countless worlds. Her laughter peals out. He's a cavalier? Not cavalier. A cavalier of the highest order. I tired of his incessant... Whinging? Whining? Long ago. The Numenera are wondrous and deadly in equal measure, although, her laugh chimes in the air, Allegern will doubtless tell you I am the most deadly of all. Alright, let's keep going. Of course, dear. Okay. I've seen this. I've seen these things. In like a demo or something. The water is clear, almost unnaturally so, revealing ruins upon ruins as far as you can see. Cool. This jagged hole is where you crash through the dome. Pretty cool.
Go.
What are these?
Let's go.
Two floating cones whirl and spin deliriously around each other, giggling like children being tickled. The air around them smells of sweet burning leaves. Watch them for patterns. Why not? The longer you stare at these artifacts, the more you're convinced that they turn faster when their spiraling paths cross each other. So using my mystical lore knowledge here, their edges seem to trace faint glowing lines that twine around each other, resembling a rope fastened to some invisible point beyond this time and place. What are you? The cones continue whirling and laughing like enraptured dancers, giving no sign that they've heard you. What are you for? The cones greet your question with a split second of hushed silence, following by delighted peals of helpless giggling. I would laugh too if someone asked me, what are you for? Allegorin's got it. They aren't for anything. They're from one of the worlds before this one. He rubs a hand along his stubble jaw. Sometimes the Numenera will do something useful. Sometimes they'll turn you inside out. And sometimes they don't do a damn thing that makes sense. Calistus says, I've often said the same thing about you, darling. Let's try speaking again. Childlike laughter is their only response. Try to touch one with quick fingers. I'm just gonna go like this. I didn't want to, like, touch them, like, with power. I was probably using dexterity or something, agility. You manage to graze one of them with the tip of your finger. Rorn, a voice says, and your vision is stolen from you. What? A moon hangs over you, but it is not one you recognize. It's black and in a pearl-white sky. Thick, flat asteroids orbit it like petals in the wind. You feel questing tendrils at your ankle, and the hot wind on your face smells of scorched hair and grief. Mm. Your vision returns. The cones hang motionless for only a second before resuming their giggling dance. You said Rorn. Or something said Rorn. Nope. Still childlike laughter. Okay. Well, like he said, we can't really do much with them, can we? What's this?
Ready.
Oh. There's just, like, money and stuff just laying on the ground. Another 22 shin, another fleetfoot moss, and an lutriated force. What the hell is that? Heals 3 points of might. This crystal pulses with vibrant energy, softly expanding and contracting, as if breathing in and out. A needle protrudes from the crystal's center. If inserted into a vein, the crystal's pulsing energy can be absorbed to increase the user's physical stamina and muscle mass for a short time. These crystals are purified from a murky liquid found rarely in the Garavia Sound. Their origin is unknown, and the process to harvest them without destroying the active substance is difficult, but the supply appears plentiful. Okay, so this heals might. This heals intellect. And this heals health. And this heals speed. I'm trying to remember that. Might, speed, intellect, and health. Alright, so we're gonna go check out this weird cube thing here. What is this?
Of course.
Oh wait, that's in... No, not yet, not yet. That's interact, yeah.
Ready.
My god, I don't know where to go. Oh my god, there's so many things to look at. Well, this I just look at. A yawning intake marks the front of a long dead construct. Inside, the metal is pitted, black, and ancient. Some kind of, like, virtual bridge or something. Although this cube hovers in the air, you can feel the ground shudder with its vibrations. A long cable extends from this spout, but at the point where it dips below the water, it's been snapped in half. No idea what any of this crap is, but I guess that's the point, isn't it? This massive construct was trying to climb across the top of the reef when it died, quote-unquote. Its surface is pocked with tiny scars and scorch marks. Cobalt petals fold over a short metal stem. Calcified minerals holds the ancient weapon closed. A cable connects this spout to the collection device. The nozzle looks like it may have been attached to another machine at one time. The strange lines and rippling forms of the sunken buildings are dramatically different from the architecture above the waterline. And finally this thing. This device is collecting black goop from somewhere underwater and pumping it to the nearby spout. So do these things have to do with this thing? Which is a construct that died. These are parts of the construct? Or are they something else? Oh, look at that. It's a giant pack of five gum. Alright,
it's a plan.
Let's interact with this thing. Whatever this is, a hole or wait. Wow. Yeah, it's some kind of like blob structure under the water, it appears.
Yes, now.
A bubbling mass of sludge floats on the surface of the water. Every once in a while, an oily nodule separates from it and hurtles into the sky. You catch momentary glimpses of a muck-coated object in the putrid mass. Examine the sludge. Carefully, you lean closer to the heaving mass. After a moment's study, you notice that the globules rising into the sky always contains something. Yeah, I gotta say, I noticed those things floating up into the sky. And be it a shining core of untainted seawater or a tiny fish. The currents within the sludge move in a repeating pattern that suggests mechanical function rather than organic life. Is this really wise? I'm gonna ram my hand in this thing. Attempt to retrieve the object trapped in the sludge. Why not? Success! The next time sunlight strikes the object's streaked surface, you're ready. You snatch it from the oily mass and clean it as best you can. So we've gained fresh vapors. Callister says, I'm not sure whether that awful muck is harmless, or you are immensely lucky. Either way, Do go on poking things, dear. It's quite entertaining. Search for more objects. You spot no other mysterious objects in the bubbling mass. Minutes tick past as you patiently wait beside the massive sludge. Nothing surfaces. Okay, we're done. What do we have? Some kind of vapors? What? Oh, is this... Wait. Oh, it's a cipher thing. Fresh vapors. So, like all the cipher things, we can use them only once. Heals 10 points of intellect and confers fresh vapors, which is a +1 intellect edge. So I'm guessing this, the +1 intellect can go over your max intellect. A simmering jar, or it increases your max intellect, either one. A simmering jar, oh, 5 uses. So cipher you can only use once, but this is 5 uses. A simmering jar made of metallic glass. Inside the jar rests a strange miasma. Its crystals sit... Sorry. Its vapors sit crystalline and perfectly still until held. The glass vessel twists and writhes when grasped. When you put your ear to the device and listen closely, sounds of weeping and hysterical laughter rise from within. Warm to the touch, once inhaled, the vessel becomes ice cold. The user feels panic, fear, nausea, and then sweet relief, a torrent of emotions akin to getting a full rest. Interesting. So, my cipher limit is 3. Can I remove one? I don't think I can. I think I can only use it or discard it. Now gradually, as I get more ciphers, well, when I go over my limit, it's going to start inflicting penalties on me. Which means I have to either discard it or use it. That's what it seems like to me anyway. What's this thing?
Let's go.
Oh, I'm gonna interact? No, no. I don't wanna go in there yet. Let's go down here.
There we go then.
Check this out. I can interact with this thing too.
With alacrity.
Some kind of like brambles or something? Whoops. They look like grasping hands. A tangled cluster of metallic tendrils grows from the depths of the nearby water. Strangely, they resembled clawed alien hands, most of which have 7 or 8 fingers. Examine. The hands sway softly, but their movements are difficult to follow. Watching them for too long makes you feel nauseous. Apart from the hands themselves, you don't notice anything of interest in the cluster. Break off one of the hands? Is it gonna attack me? Ooh. You grip the hand nearest to you and snap it from its roots. Stepping back, you give a couple experimental swings. Good balance. It might make a decent weapon. So we now have an 8-fingered mace. Allegrin says, you aren't happy unless you're breaking things. Are you? You wrap your hands around one of the wrists and pull with all your strength. Eventually, gasping, you give up. The tendrils seem thicker and stronger now, as if they fortified themselves against you. I'm sure they have, actually. Chemical damage. Oh. This metallic object resembles a clenched 8-fingered hand attached to a forearm. You snapped it off a metallic tendril in the Reef of Fallen Worlds. It has a decent haft and balance, and its steely material is powerful enough to deal significant damage, but it's only a makeshift weapon and is somewhat clumsy to use. Can I even use it? I don't think I have skill in this thing. 2. Plus 2 damage, max plus 6. I guess I can use it. I just want to look at these here. Cool. I guess we can use it. Yeah, I really can't remove these things. 5 uses. What about this thing? I guess 1 use. Okay. Huh.
Ready.
Okay, what's this giant pack of gum? A matte black obelisk floats in midair above the water. It has sharp, curved sides that converge to a glowing tip that brightens or dims with the passing of the bay's faint breezes. Well, we can either try to touch it or just do nothing, so let's try to touch it. This is going to end in my doom at some point, touching and breaking everything. You raise your hand toward the obelisk. Dull green light wells from within the black stone, fixed on you like a furious eye. Allegrin says, I knew someone who did what you're about to do. He says casually, Aeon Priest. A beam came out the top of that thing and ripped his face off. Made a fancy nightlight out of his crystal necklace, though. But hey, I'm sure you know what you're doing. Oh, hush, Calistage says. At least that poor priest died in service of his curiosity, rather than stumbling about the coast complaining and feeling sorry for himself. Go ahead if you must, she tells you, ignoring Allegern's glare, but do be careful. Let's stretch out the crystal shard toward the obelisk instead. Carefully, you level the shard at the obelisk, and a superheated beam lances from the top of the structure into the crystal, sending vibrations up your arm and suffusing the shard with a warm green glow. Really? Oh! We all gain XP, and it looks like I got hurt or something. Oh, I still have all my hit points. I guess this is the level up, like if we get all the way, you click plus and level up. Alright, so this is our tides. Right. These changed before, like in the last 3 episodes. The silver tide represents prestige, power, and renown. People attuned to this tide desire admiration and respect, all the more because of the influence it gives them in the lives of others. Leaders, celebrities, heroes, and autocrats are often attuned to these tides, to this tide. The blue tide represents wisdom, reason, and enlightenment. People attuned to this tide seek information and the preservation of knowledge in all forms, whether scientific or spiritual. Scholars, teachers, guides, and mystics are often attuned to this tide. Okay. So I want power and renown as well as I have wisdom and enlightenment. Ooh, this thing just got upgraded. In the Reef of Fallen Worlds, a superheated beam from a mysterious black obelisk struck the shard, infusing the crystal with the obelisk's power. Oh, I don't know. I wish I could compare, like have a compare thing. See, this is cool, though, because it's 4 damage and 3 chemical damage. 2 damage per effort applied. What is she using? This is pretty good, too. I guess I'll just hold on to it for now. And he's, Allegern's using this mace. Yeah, I'll just hold on to it for now. Yeah, I don't think I should mess with that thing anymore.
Let's do it.
Let's do it, baby. So I guess we'll go over here. Oh wait, we got some loot over here. Grab that first. Oh, look at these statues. Pretty awesome. 17 shin. Another one of these elutriated force things and an encephalic rush. So our intellect and might healers. And they stack. Excellent. Can we go in this thing then? This metal door is thick, heavy, and unmarked by time. Double rows of circular bumps run horizontally and vertically across its surface. It is firmly sealed. Let's examine it more carefully. The metal surface is infused with minuscule threads that are barely visible to the human eye. They only run in straight lines and right angles, and they seem to converge at the circular bumps. Upon closer inspection, you notice that each of the bumps is unique. Some have flat faces, others are actually many-sided polygons, and a few are marked by tiny apertures. Really? Unfortunately, you don't see anything that resembles a knob, keyhole, or access device. You try touching both the flat planes of the door and the small bumps, but nothing happens. You don't find anything that seems to be an access device, and touching the door has no effect. Knock. You knock lightly at first, then harder. The door makes no sound at all, nor does it shudder or yield. There's no one home, dear, Callister says. Hasn't been for thousands of years. She peers at the door. One of my colleagues at the Order claimed that she got inside, but I don't believe her.
All right.
Oh, about this. Oh, we looked at that, right? The strange lines and rippling forms of the sunken building are dramatically different from the architecture above the waterline.
It's a plan.
So we've barely made it at all into this place. And I only see one way to go at this point.
Fine.
Across this awesome, like, I don't know. Oh, something hitting these. Somebody just slammed into that. Oh yeah, there it goes. Huh. Alright guys, tune back next time when we go over the bridge of, I don't know what you would call it, cybermancy. Thanks for watching, see you next time, and endure. And enduring, grow strong.